Welcome everybody, my name is Jan, and today we will be talking about coins and credits in pinball, or how to get rich fast. I mean, to be honest, if you put your machine on location, you usually enable coin play, but I guess most people won't get rich by like operating a pinball machine on location. Just compare the price of a pinball machine to the price of a game, and you will see that there have to be a lot of plays to make money at all. But I guess it kind of to prevent one person from standing there all day, right? So it kind of has to be there on location, but I guess like most machines are not there to make extra money. But nevertheless, let's see how that works if you want to do it. So I prepared a small agenda. It's first about credits. So what is credits in pinball in general, and how do we understand it in MPF? Then we will talk about coin and bill validators. I think they're called like this way. Sometimes they're called bill or coin acceptors, sometimes coin max, but I found that validator seems to be the common name. Then we will talk shortly about pricing tiers, also very common in pinball, and we will get into that. Afterwards, yeah, I will give like a brief overview about which components interact in MPF to make this happen. And yeah, after that, we will have demo time and look into my example machine, which I prepared, and yeah, put in some coins and have a little bit of fun. So, let's get started. Credits in pinball. So, in general, it works this way that you need one credit to start a game. And if you add another player, you need another credit. So, generally, one credit per player in game. And so, that's basically the universal currency in pinball. And the reason for that is that there are usually different ways to get a credit. So either you insert coins or bills, but then, I mean, depending on which value your coin is, you get different amounts of credits and how many games you can play. But there might also be things like extra credits due to high score, like especially in older machines, it's often called replay. Or sometimes also due to like bonus or like this this extra credit thingy where at the end of the game you get like a random number, and when it matches the end of your score, then you get like an extra credit. So, I mean, it looks super like random, but in most machines that's super rigged. Also like in MPF, it's also rigged. You can enter the percentage, how often this matches. So the machine usually first determines if you will get the credit and then calculate which value it should show, right? So that's what it typically does. And then there are often like some more tricks. If you had like a four-player game and you got two credits, you get like a higher chance of getting an extra credit so that you got three. And then, yeah, you're four players, so you have to add another coin to get this last credit. So depending on your country, this might be gambling and illegal or something, but at least this option exists in a lot of machines, and depending on your country, this might also be the operator default for a lot of machines. And we kind of also support this kind of stuff in MPF. Yeah, so that's the general idea why we got credits. So how do I get credits? So yeah, I already told that, but if I want to accept coins or bills, then there are generally like three ways. So there are those single coin acceptors. Those basically only accept like a quarter or $1 coin or 1 euro bill or something. So they are country specific and they accept only one specific coin. And typically what they do is when you put in a coin and it's valid, it drops into the coin basically box below, and it will pulse one input on your pinball controller system or pinball, on your pinball controller. Then there are like multi-coin inputs and also multi-bill validators. I don't know if they are single bill validators, but I guess like most of them are multi-bills. So they can detect like multiple bills or multiple coins. And the way that works is usually that you program them. And how you get into this programming mode is very, very different. Sometimes you have to press a button, set a jumper, something, but often you also need a separate programmer for that. And then you enter programming mode and you just enter 10 or 20 coins of the type you want, and it basically learns how they look, how much they weight, how they are basically feeling on their magnet and stuff like that, how fast they roll, how large they are. So depending on the type, there are like a few criteria and it can usually learn those. I bought like a cheap validator from China, and yeah, it can learn any coin I got. It can learn like the magic tokens from Safecracker. That worked really, really well. Not the most reliable choice, but for like $15 it has been okay. Same for bill validators. I never actually played with one because like they're not very common here in Germany, but in the US you often see them on machines. And the way you interface those is typically via one of those 10 pin connectors, 2x5. It's typically this ribbon cable, which then connects to a board in your cabinet on the left. And the layout often looks like those, like this one here, right? So I've seen multiple ones and they almost all of them got this pin out. And what that is basically you got two pins for power, and this might also be like here or some, that might be a little bit swapped, right? I don't think that this is standardized. I'm not actually sure. So check the data sheet of your validator. And so you give it power, usually 12 volts. And if it detects a coin, so this is coin 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, depending on the validator, there might be 1 to 6. Often 4, 5, 6 different outputs, and you program those and then it will pulse one of those outputs. So for example, you could program a quarter here, 50 cents, $1, $2, and then it would just pulse those outputs. You put them to your pinball control system, you connect them to your pinball control system, and then that's fine. Active low is also what you usually want, because your input will be pulled up and this will then drive it down. So that would perfectly work here. And you can have a few of those. Additionally, what they often can do is they can pulse those multiple times. So for example, if you want to save wires, you can have this input at like a quarter, and then for 50 cents, you would just have it pulse the same coin one twice. So that like your machine gets the same input as if you entered like two quarters. And then for $1, you would have four pulses and so on. So that also works in a lot of those validators, and that might save you inputs. But what I've seen on most machines is that, like commercial machines, right? They typically got like four inputs, four coins, and there's rarely a fifth or sixth. So for example, on Safecracker, there's a fifth that's always used for the magic token for like the special game, but usually that's just four. So that's very simple to wire up. So I had a lot of respect how this worked, because I thought it would be serial or something, but most of the validators got this interface. They often got like 3-4 interfaces, but they also got this kind of interface, and that interfaces very, very easily with like almost any pinball controller. And that's already like how you connect it. Then we got like pricing tiers. That's also like very, very common. So often you see like this kind of layout, right? You give it a quarter, it will get you half a credit. You get it 50 cents, you get one credit. So far linear, right? Then you add you put in like $1, you get two credits. But then you add $2 and instead of 4 credits you get 5. And this actually like adds up. You do not have to put in $2 at once. You can also put $2 $1 or 4 50 cents or a lot of quarters in there, and like, yeah, 8 quarters, and then you will also get like 5 credits. So that's pricing tiers. Typically there's like a timeout where this happens, so you can add this, and after 10 minutes so for example you could put $1 and wait 10 minutes, put another dollar, and then you would not get 5 credits but just 4. So there's often a timeout for that. Additionally, there's often a timeout for fractional credits, so that the machine will, I don't know, like after half an hour or 20 minutes, it will drop the fractional credits if you did not fill them up. Also, credits might expire after some time, so like after 2 hours or something, all the credits get deleted in your machine. And sometimes even if the machine is off, this timeout is faster. So if you turn it off for an hour, it will also lose all the credits. But if you just turn it off for like 10 minutes, they will stay there. So that's what the general logic, what's happening there in a pinball machine, at least from what I've seen and what we also implemented in MPF. That's what we got. So how does that like work? How do you configure that? And that's relatively simple, I would say. So first you configure those credit switches, which I just explained how you wire those up. And then you enable credits mode and configure it accordingly, right? There you configure your pricing tiers, and map your switches to like, to the value and so on. Do configure all the timeouts, some slides for entering, for adding credits and so on. And then you have credits play in general. So that will be enough to enable credits, have your machine take credits, and also subtract credits when the game starts. So that credit mode takes care of that. Then you might want to have bonus or high score mode. Those that can be used to like award replays or whatever. I mean, you can also replay, reward replays during your game using some event. That's also possible. And like, yeah, then you can, for example, also have like this score counter at the end and so on. And finally, there's service mode. Service mode can be used to get like any kind of audits and also disable free play and credits play. Theoretically, you could also add settings for your pricing tiers and so on. So what we currently do not have is like what you see on a lot of Sterns or WPC machines, where you can edit the pricing tiers in the operator's menu. That's something we currently do not have in MPF. If anybody of you like wants to get serious and put like an MPF machine on location, talk to us please, and we can help you make this happen. So currently, yeah, you can do this with like some settings, but it might not be as fancy as it is on WPC, where you have like very, very crazy logic. Ticket dispensers, does MPF support a signal? Not like out of the box. So you could have, for example, a player or machine variable where you could keep your tickets and then you print those out, but at the moment there's no support whatsoever. So I don't know, do you have a ticket dispenser? I actually never like even got close to one, I think. They're not very common in Germany. And none of the guys which have pinball machines at their home have one. So, yeah. So what do you do with those tickets? I honestly have no idea. Do you win stuff with those, or how does it work? Because like, or you probably won't get your money back, right? Or is it just to play other machines with it in an arcade or something? Yeah, okay. Yeah, I've seen those, but I've never actually Maybe I got those when visiting the US. Yeah, cool. Yeah, maybe. I mean, if you want to build it, we can help you to make it happen. Just you probably have to tell us how the logic should work, because I honestly don't know. So not exactly, at least. But yeah, it would be totally possible to have it like based on your score or something, and then have it dispense tickets. Why not? Would be fun, I guess. And that's already what I had theoretically. So now it's demo time. Let's jump into it. Yeah, Safecracker like does that exactly. So Safecracker is like during the game, there are some random chances to get like a coin dispensed, and that's basically above the playfield, right? It's from the back box and it will roll down over the glass to you as a player. It's super cool. And there's also, I think there's one mode if you make it, or if you break into the bank, I think you get 3 of those coins or so. There are multiple ways to get those coins. And but that's like more like an event during the game, right? So that you can do a coin player and pulse the coin to eject one of those coins, for example. That would be super simple. If that's it, I guess in most cases it is this simple, right? So that would work almost out of the box. I mean, it probably doesn't require like special logic at all. So to the demo. Let's just have MPF running for now. That will look nicer. So what I prepared is the following. I created a new configuration here for my machine just to make it like simple, right? So here what I did is I added the credits mode to the list of my modes. Very convenient, otherwise we won't have credits. And the next thing which I did is I added like 4 coin switches, and those are like for now very simple: quarter, 50 cent, $1, $2. If that's realistic or not depends on your country, right? But I guess that's quite kind of common. I added like an event player to post an event toggle credit play. That's something I've been asked for. So how do you check how do you like enable or disable replay or credit play during the game? And I will show you. It's very simple. But it's not very well documented, I found out, because I had to actually search for it a little bit. I knew where it was, so I knew where to look, but I had to search for it a little bit. Then what I did is I added like some text onto my segment display, and you see my segment display here on the right. So it says credits 0 at the moment. I mean, it's only 7 like digits, so it cuts it off at the left. So you probably do not want to put this on segment displays, but I thought it would be fun, so I did that. And color red. And now there's like a special credits configuration block, and that's where you like configure the general credits. And like you can define like maximum credits, it's 12 in this case, and we disable free play by default, and that's very important. That's just the default setting, so this can be changed during runtime and will also be persisted when your game is like stopped and started again. But if there are no settings in your machine, right, if they have been wiped because of a reset or for some reason, then this will be like your initial setting. That's it. You can have a service credit switch. That's my service door switch, right? Very common that you, when the operator presses it, that you will get like 1 credit. And then we can map our switches. So what I just told is like, I can map my switches to different values. So switch 1 is 25 cents, 2 is 50 cents, 3 is $1, and 4 is $2. very simple. And I also configured the pricing tiers, which I just talked about. So like 50 cents is one credit and $2 or dollars is 5 credits. And then MPF will calculate the rest. So it will figure out that 50 cents is then half a credit and so on. Here's the fractional credits expiration time, credits expiration time, and how long it should persist the credits when the machine's off. Additionally, there are like two strings. It's free play string and credit string. That's more for convenience. And it will create like a machine variable for you, which is called credit string, same as this variable. And that's also what I used here. So I just show this credit string variable on the display here. And that will be either free play or whatever credits you have. And that's often very useful for slides because that's exactly what you want to show. And that will usually get it right. Additionally, I mapped the coins to my keyboard so that I can play with it easily. So additionally, I copied from the documentation how those slides should look. So into the credits mode, so into my modes folder, credits config credits YAML, I added some slides based on some standard events. So like credits added, not enough credits, enabling free play, enabling credits play, max credits reached, and if you added a player. In this case, there will be like a pop-up slide, which shows usually the credit string and some more stuff here. Also like some sounds for inserting a coin and so on. So very, very simple, but that's what it should be, right? It should be like boring. It should just be working. That's not our business. We just want to have it working. And that's already like how you configure this in general. So that will give you like a very, very basic configuration, which just works. And now I got like a machine here. It's on credits play by default, free play is off. And now I can, for example, press start. And then it will say insert credits, credit zero. And the game won't start. Right? That makes sense. So now I can also enable free play. So I pressed one. Now the credit string will be free play. And now I could like start the game. Practically I can't because the machine doesn't have any balls. But it doesn't show the error anymore, right? So it would start the game now. Now let's toggle credits play again. And now we can like add credits. So let's start with like the quarter. Did I press? Oh, I did press service credits. What did I press? I pressed I, I think. What is I? It's coin two. It'll give us only one, but you should give us 50. So something worked wrong here. Let's try it again. Delete the data. Okay, so we got 50 cents and that should give us one credit. Let's try again. Okay, here's my machine. Here is the window and that's the start and the credits, 0 credits, and we should get you. Yeah, and you give us half a credit. So that's the credit strings now. Can we start the game? No. Can I press you again? Yes. Then I get 1 credit because now I got 50 cents for the first credit. And now we can like check the credit, the pricing tier, right? So I can add a quarter again. I got 1.5, 2, 2.5, 3, 3.5, 4, 4.5. Now it gets interesting. Oh yeah, sorry. I already got, no, didn't get 4, I get 5. Yeah. Hope you saw that, right? So from 1.5, it went to it went to sorry, from 3.5 it went to 5, not to 4, right? Because then we reached like the 2 bucks and then it went over. That's basically how it works. I can also like enter like at like 2 more credits, then I should get 5 additional ones. And yeah. That did work? Maybe not. Maybe that doesn't work all the time. Maybe that doesn't only works if you put the initial 2 in. Not sure if that actually repeats or not. Should it repeat? I don't know. Interesting question. So now we could start, press start, and it would start the game if it had a game, had a ball. Let's add a ball here. And now it will start the game, right? And now I can also add a second player, and it should repeat. Yeah, I guess so. So that would be something which we might have to fix. I guess we do not have a test case for that. And that also speaks for very little testing in credits play, but I guess that's usual. Yeah, right. So if you add 2 times 2 euros, then you should get the tiers 2 times. Yeah, I would also expect that, but didn't happen. So we can add more players, obviously. Now we got 4 players, and that's it. But let's try that. I mean, easiest way to find out is delete everything, start it up again, and now add 2 credits, 5, yeah, and 2 credits again, 5 again. That worked, right? So the easiest case, the simple case worked. But now what happens if we do something like this? We put in 5 credits, we put in 0.5 credit, and we put 2, yeah. And there it fails, right? So we put in 2, 1/4, 1/4, and 2 again, and then it doesn't work. And that's not so great in my opinion. Maybe we have to look into that. yeah, not sure. Because like it works for 4, but it doesn't work for, right? So if I put 2, 2, it works fine. But if I do 2, 1/4, 2, then it doesn't work. And it also should work when that happens, right? So I guess it looks like for the complete number or something. So interesting, to be honest. But also probably not too hard to calculate. But it looks like we down, so because now we get 2.5 instead of 2, and it probably doesn't cover that case. So let's try again. 2, and now fill it up with 1s, right? 1, 2, 3, yeah, and then it works again. But if we skip this number, then it doesn't. Okay, consider that as a bug. As usual, we will find bugs on stream if you just experiment with the stuff. So one thing which I learned at university when I was like teaching is that often you properly understand stuff when you teach it the first or second time, because then you have to like really think into it and get all those crazy questions and have to prepare for it, and then you really dig into the stuff and find the bugs like here. So that's awesome. Yeah, in general, like that's already how like credits work. Now I already showed you that we can post an event to toggle like free play. So we can, for example, add a few credits, then toggle free play. And now we can just start a game if we had a ball. So let's add a ball and start the game. And if you would see the machine. Yeah, it started the game. And now, should I drain the boy? Yeah, probably can do that, right? I did this wrong. So let's delete it. Should I delete it? Right. At credits, we can toggle to free play, and we can also go back, and it should like remember the credits, as you can see here. So that generally works. So you might want to do it this way. So this way you can have like a toggle event. You can also have an event to enable or disable free play. The other way is simply to enter service mode. So we can go into service mode. This is actually interesting. I saw that earlier. If you enter service mode, it will always go to the free play credit string. And the reason for that is that when we go to free play, we will unload the service mode. And so sorry, the credits mode. And then we switch to the free play, even if we're not in free play now. So we can go out. And now we should see like credits again. So we can go in, we can go out. And diagnostics menu, yeah, that's also a thing. So we can, if we want to like toggle free play, we can go into adjustments menu, and there's coin adjustments, and there's a setting credits play free play. So we can set it to free play, exit service menu, and we still like the credit string is still free play, right? We can go back in adjustments, coin adjustments, and go to credits again. So it's that simple. There's also like a little bit more, and there is audits menu where you can have your credit audits. So your how much did you earn, total income, coins and money. That's a standard function. So this has been like extended a lot in 055, has been a joint effort from James, from Anthony, from me. Kind of like a few people wanted a better service menu, and we added so like not all this stuff. So if you look at the WPC standard menu, there's a lot of functions there. We did not add all of those, but like the most important ones, for example, audits for your earnings. What you can see here is like there's like an audit earning for money. And you probably have noticed that there's money here. It's a type money. And you can also have like different types here, like type replay. And then you will get like a different audit for replays here or for, I don't know, whatever you want. So that also works. So we got earnings, we got player, we got event, we got shot audits, we got switch audits. There you can also see probably the coin switches. You cannot, because if I trigger them by keyboard, they won't be here. diagnostics. Got coils, but utilities, there's reset menu. And that can reset coin audits, that can reset to factory settings, that can also reset credits if you want. That can reset high scores, game audits, coin audits. Let's reset credits. Yes. And credits is zero. It's that easy. So this kind of stuff is there in 055, which just has been released on Sunday. Has been a great Sunday. And so far, no complaints. I'm very happy. Probably nobody installed it yet. I don't know, to be honest, but I hope that it just works for everybody. But usually, like, we find out a little bit later if it doesn't. That's already like installed. Awesome. Thanks for testing it. That's great. That's like already how this works. That's volume. It also works. Like my service switches, I can also add like the escape button, right? And then I will get like operator credits here. And this should also show up in earnings here for service credit awards. That's basically the the audit for what the operator did. And now we can, yeah, we can also like use a utilities menu to read that the coin audits. Yes. And now we should, we do not have any audits anymore. that's so easy, and it just works. Another thing which we can see is now if I stop the machine and without deleting the data directory, we can also look at the data directory. There is first my own earnings file, which is now reset, and there's also the machine variables, and that contains the credit units I got here and how and when it will expire, and also it will it contains the free play value. So basically, if it's enabled or not, right? So now I can start up the machine again, and it should pick up the credits. It didn't. The timestamp actually looked bad there. So let's try again. It should remember those, but it looks like that something went wrong with the timestamp there. So another bug, already two on the stream. Isn't going well. So I have to write it down now. Timeout and credits. I mean, yeah, I think we got a test for that, but testing timings is usually very tricky. And the second one is credit tiers for like if there's a half more than I need or something. That should also work, but it doesn't at the moment. So that's good. But what we should see is, let's see if that works. So we can now enable free play, for example. Now we got free play here. We can stop the machine, start it again, and it should still be on free play. Yeah, that works. We can toggle it to credit play again. And now if I stop it, it should still be in credit play. Yeah, that works. I will fix the credits. Yeah, that's right. That's what I had, what I got. Do you have any questions? Anything else I should show? What you want to see? Then please write it in the chat or in the comments if you're watching this later. Yeah, hope you had some fun. Hope you learned something. And yeah. Have a great time, build some pinball, play some pinball, and see you next time, guys.